Hello and welcome to Now is the Time. I'm Mary Crowley. We have a really great program today. On the show with me today is Josie Pollack, who used to live a life with the jet setters, traveled all over the world on private jets and yachts with movie stars and rock stars. She was engaged to the drummer Nigel Owson of Elton John's band. And the most fascinating thing about this whole story tonight, I believe, is not only the fact that Jesus, you know, brought her into the kingdom and she became a born-again Christian, but the night that Sharon Tate was murdered in 1969 in Beverly Hills, Los Angeles here in California, she was supposed to have been at the house the night, but she had a headache, and somehow God pretty much delayed her going that night, and the next day, she found out about these horrific killings and how literally her life had been spared. Welcome to the program, Josie.
Thank you, Mary. Good to be here.
Wow, what a story. So let's go into that a little bit for the viewers. You know, Sharon Tate was an actress, and you had met her when she was 17 because your husband had actually called her up to be an actress in one of his films?
No, he was making a film in Italy, and Sharon was living there because her father was in the service, and they brought her onto the set, and she was beautiful, and they just stuck her in the film to be an extra.
Okay, so you knew her when she was just 17, a young
teenager. Yes.
Okay, and so you continued the relationship
with her. Well, I ran into her again when she came to Hollywood, and we started hanging out. And the night, I had seen her on a Tuesday night at a club. And I said, oh, Sharon, I was up at your house. And she said, well, when are you coming over? I'm home now. I was booking the Greek Theater at the time, working day and night. I said, it's going to be difficult. And she said, well, try and come this weekend because Roman's still in London.
Now, at this point, she had married Roman Polanski,
yes,
who was a director.
Polish director, yes. And while I was talking to her, I was on the phone with my roommate, and I said, Sharon, what's your new number? And I said to my roommate, write this number down. This was Tuesday. Thursday, I flew to Las Vegas for Anthony Newley's opening because I wanted to put him into the theater, and I took my boss to see him, and while I was there, I got this terrible migraine, and my friends that live there said, Josie's sick. Let her stay over and forget about work tomorrow. So I stayed over. They booked me a late afternoon, early evening flight back. I got home. My roommate had left town. I looked everywhere for Sharon's number. And I thought, I'm not going to just drive over there because, you know, plans change. I'll go over tomorrow. And as I was getting ready to go over the next day, it came on the news about all these bodies found in a house in Beverly Hills. And that's how God saved my life.
Well, and for some of you watching who don't know, this happened a long time ago. In fact, a book was released, but Sharon's sister just came out with this book.
Yes.
On the cover of it is a picture of Sharon Tate. She was a famous actress who married a famous director, Roman mm-hmm. Polanski. And Josie was supposed to come over that night that they were murdered. There was several people that was murdered that night. And Sharon Tate had been 8 months pregnant. And there was a group of people that were under this man named Charles Manson, the Manson family. They were ordered by them to go in and to kill the people that were in the house. Terry Melcher had turned down Charles Manson for a recording contract. And he thought Terry Melcher, who was the son of Doris Day, I think that they were sent there to kill this man. But they didn't realize that Roman Polanski, Sharon Tate, had rented the house. So this is what happened, and you were supposed to be there that night, but God had literally saved you from a horrific death.
I couldn't read anything about the story or anything because I was in shock, and it wasn't until I saw the film Helter Skelter that I realized the maid found the bodies on a Saturday. Now, a lot of maids don't work in Beverly Hills on a Saturday, So if she hadn't gone in, I would have been the one to find the bodies. So God saved me from that too.
Yeah, and according, because I've studied, you know, a little bit, because I'm working on a film about the 60s and the 70s with the Jesus movement, and Manson happened to be involved with the story. Mm-hmm. And so I researched that time, and what they did is they wrote in blood of the victims all over the wall, Helter Skelter, that had to do with the Beatles, I think, song.
Yeah.
But anyway, so let's go into your past. So you're from England,
but
is that correct?
There's a little added thing to that. Years later, I'm ministering at a women's prison, and who should walk out talking about Jesus but the woman that cut the baby out of Sharon? And all this anger rose up in me. I just wanted to throttle her. And how dare she talk about Jesus, this monster? And God spoke to me and said, hey, you minister to people, others have to forgive. Where's your forgiveness?
Yeah, Susan Atkins was the one. And then yeah. Charles Tex Watson was another of the killers. They both, there were several of them, but both of those two had accepted the Lord later on. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's go back into your past. So now you were from England?
Yes, I was born in London.
Okay, and so you were a model and an actress?
Yes.
And so kind of go into a little bit about your past, what happened
well,
as an actress.
Well, I was a model and an actress, and then I met this very handsome man who I willed into my life. I was working in a nightclub to pay for my acting lessons, and this gorgeous guy would walk in, and I would say, he just can't stay away from me. He keeps coming in, and he never even noticed me. But every time he came in, I'd go, here he is again. Well, he was a magician that worked at the club down the street. And I ended up marrying him and becoming a magician's assistant.
Wow. And so you actually then, when did you come over to the States?
In 59.
And you were on the Ed Sullivan Show and actually worked with Liberace?
Yeah, we went straight to Vegas to the Stardust Hotel. And that was the first time I appeared on stage with him. And he used to put birds in a cage and make the cage disappear. And I took one of the birds out that he would make disappear. But as I pushed the cage forward, all the birds fell on the floor of the cage, and I didn't know which one to give him. I thought I'd ruined his act, but it worked out fine.
So, but now you started hobnobbing with a lot of celebrities and different people in Hollywood, people that were known names at the time around the world?
Yeah, yeah. But this was probably after my divorce from Channing. I mean, I knew a lot of celebrities before. My best friend was Diana Dawes. She was Britain's answer to Marilyn Monroe. And you remind me a bit of Diana. So look her up.
Okay. Well, now, so now you're around all these people that are famous and mm-hmm. wealthy, and you're traveling on private jets. And mm-hmm. when did you start dating Elton John's drummer?
In 1972.
And so you'd be on these jets flying around the world to these parties and on yachts. And did these people seem superficial? Did they seem like they were unhappy?
It was all depending. Usually the star themselves were very nice and quite humble. It was often the people around them that had attitudes. You know, they try and keep people away from the star. But there wasn't a lot of happiness with all the fame and wealth. I still know a lot of people that were depressed.
So a lot of these
people didn't realize that at that time all they needed was Jesus.
Well, now you brought some pictures that we're going to put up on the screen now. Let's put up those pictures on the screen of you with some of the different people in the past that you've been around, one of them being Clint Eastwood. Mina, put, okay. So now, That's
Freddie Mercury.
Okay. And he was of Queen.
Queen. There's John Lennon, Neil Sedaka, and Nigel Maypang.
That's you right next in the...
Maypang and myself. There's Elton, Nigel, myself. That's Gracie Field. She was a very famous singer during the war.
Who's this?
That's Johnny Mathis. That's my ex-husband in better days.
Yes.
The Smothers Brothers. And see that dress? My ex-husband cut all my clothes up and that dress.
Who is this right here?
Tom Jones.
Okay.
Engelbert Humperdinck.
Okay, and you're the one to the right there.
Yep. That's Elton, David Johnson, Iggy Pop, myself, and Nigel. There's lovely Michael Jackson.
Okay.
Sammy Davis Jr.
And that's you to the right?
And my friend Joanna Ray, she's a casting director. And there were more.
Who's that right there?
That's Clint.
Clint Eastwood, okay, yeah. That's good.
We're back. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. And so you were around a lot of different celebrities, but mm-hmm. you got to a point where you realized, how did you come to come to know Jesus?
Well, I actually always knew Jesus. I just didn't walk with him. I always prayed. I was involved with a drug addict that a psychic had told me I was going to marry. She said, you'll have problems, but it'll all work out, you'll get married. So I put up with a lot of nonsense, and finally I said, I can't deal with this. And I called a friend of mine who used to run in the same circles as him in London, and I said, you have to take this man off my hands. I don't want to throw him out on the streets. And he took him, and he took him to church. And this was a guy, he was gay, he was an alcoholic and a drug addict, and God got a hold of him, and he ended up saying to me, what do you want, Josie? I said, all I want is peace. And he said, with Jesus, you can have it. So he said, you have to say the sinner's prayer. I said, don't be silly, I'm not a sinner, I'm a good person. So he said, no, Josie, you're a sinner. So I said the sinner's prayer through gritted teeth. I went to church, people were raising their hands. I go, oh, Jesus, don't turn me into a Jesus freak. I just want to do this a little bit. God didn't listen. He turned me into a Jesus freak.
Wow, and then we're going to show them a clip in just a few minutes, but you actually started becoming a chaplain at the Los Angeles County Men's Jail.
I was a chaplain there for 11 years, yes.
And you actually ministered to Tommy Lee of Motley Crue one uh-huh. time, and there yeah. would be some famous people that would come through yeah. there, including O.J. Simpson.
Yeah, I didn't minister to O.J. I knew O.J. before, but I didn't minister him because Rosie Greer did that.
Okay.
But Robert Downey Jr., I ministered to him. He was in a bad state. And he is just an example of how lives can be changed.
Yes, amen. Mm-hmm. So anyway, so let's roll the clip. Actually, this was a 6-minute clip that was actually shown on PBS.
Yeah, it was made for the Silver Lake Film Festival, and PBS picked it out of all the documentaries to show.
Okay, let's roll that clip now of the 6-minute documentary, please. Yeah.
I never even liked magic, even as a child. I was going to be an actress or a model.
My name is Josie Pollock. I'm a volunteer minister in the prison system.
A lot of Bible heroes spent a lot of time locked up. Paul wrote most of the New Testament when he was in prison. If you've got a hard heart, God will change that heart because he loves you.
Why do I choose to live in Los Angeles? I think Los Angeles probably needs a missionary more than Africa. People are so self-involved here and so into money and fame and all the things that are really unimportant in the whole scheme of life. I've known people with a lot of money and a lot of fame, and they've been miserable and depressed.
The people I know that live in mansions don't have the peace that I have.
God has people giving me clothes, makeup, a new car, money. I've been living by faith for the last 12 years, and he's never let me down yet. I love to pray with people. Guys used to come into me and say, I've heard that you've got a direct line to God and I need prayer. It used to go around. So Lawrence, what do you need prayer for?
I do rap, but I curse a lot. I use like profanity. I want to serve God, but I know I can't do both.
You know, you can find another word to put in place of profanity. God will give you words to use. Rap is fine. God loves rap.
God has a great sense of humor. Look at me. Do I look like a vicar to you? That's what they call them in England, vicars.
This is my whole past in this case. Been a while since I looked in here.
That's me.
This woman wanted to be my manager and she said, they're doing hula hoops in Trafalgar Square. I said, I've never done the hula hoop. She said, oh, just pick it up. And so I start hula hooping and all the cameras start turning on me. I could move it up and down my body. This picture appeared all over the world. It became quite a career for me. I was featured on the cover of a hula hoop song, Cambridge University. I had to hula hoop all over the town on top of a taxi cab. It's been a lot of years since I've done this. I've been celibate too long. I turned the hula hoop in for the cross, I guess. Hula hoop days are over. I've got to move on to something else.
Ladies and gentlemen, that international star, Mr. Channing Pollock.
My career came to a halt when I became a magician's assistant. When he was sober, he was a wonderful guy.
Now, this is how I looked. This is how my husband made me look. He didn't want a blonde on stage because he didn't need anybody to take their eyes off of him.
There's Elton, Davy Johnston, Iggy Pop, myself and Nigel.
I always knew a lot of celebrities. I never ran after celebrities. They just happened to come into my life. I can only say it's God's favor. He's always protected me. I mean, even when I wasn't walking with him.
Migraines saved Super Groupie from Sharon Tate murders.
I should have been at Sharon Tate's that night. Circumstances stopped me going, and I believe the circumstances were caused by God.
You might say that my whole life has been magic. I was married to a magician. I had a lot of magic times. And now I guess it's real magic, helping people to transform their lives.
People in jail don't understand. No matter what they've done, God still loves them. They don't know that they can be forgiven.
Chaplain Josie?
Hey.
I can finally hug you.
Yes, ma'am. It's a blessing.
Seeing Chaplain Josie on the outs, it was just blessed. She just was so helpful and instrumental in outlining the scriptures and the process to keep that relationship with God. Meeting with her like 3-4 times a week was just a blessing.
My name is Billy Preston. I first met Josie when the Lord was punishing me for my bad behavior at the county jail. She gave me some lyrics and I put it to music. Just her heart and her spirit was so great, you know, meant a lot to me in my recovery. It was just a wonderful feeling in her services, you know. The Spirit of the Lord was there.
I went to internal affairs about deputy violence on inmates. 2 weeks later, I was accused of bringing in a hacksaw.
I think this is a hacksaw, because I saw a picture of it. This looks kind of big.
They snatched my badge, they escorted me out. I was never allowed to go pick up my belongings from my office.
Forgive them, Father, forgive them.
I had 11 years worth of notes and sermons and books and material, and it's all gone.
Now, give me a break.
It makes me feel homesick. Can you imagine anyone wanting being homesick and want to get back to jail? I never had children. I was never ever pregnant. But I felt like they were my kids. And I've been stripped away from my kids. The battle is the Lord's. If He wants me back there, then I'll be back there.
Nice one. Yeah.
So we're going to write some more together.
Yes,
you
for sure.
Heard that. You got it on record.
It's coming. It's coming. Wonderful.
Anyway, and so that was Josie Pollock, Ashley in the Jail, and that was Billy Preston?
Yes.
And Billy Preston, he had many hits in the 70s, is that right?
Oh, absolutely, yes.
Yeah, but he ended
up... You Are So Beautiful, remember that song?
Oh, yeah.
And Willie Go Around in Circles, and...
Yes. And so, well, you know, at the end of the story, so you were 11 years in the prison men's jail, and then... You had reported some type of issues that were happening.
I watched it for 11 years, deputy violence on inmates, and I finally just had it up to here, and I went to internal affairs, and 2 weeks later, I was thrown out.
They tried to accuse you and said that you brought a hacksaw in?
But years later, it's been uncovered. There are deputies right now awaiting trial or in trial for what I reported, corruption and violence.
Well, to me, that you're a hero, you know.
I'm a whistleblower.
Well, you know, you saw injustices done with people, that deputies that were beating up prisoners.
Yeah.
That was wrong.
Yeah.
But I feel, Josie, that there's some people watching right now that you've heard the story of this remarkable woman who's, you know, dated, you know, famous people. She's traveled around the world, you know, on yachts and jets and, you know, met many famous, you know, actors and celebrities and singers. And God spared her life on the night that Sharon Tate and five people got murdered, horrible Manson family murdered, only for Josie Pollock to accept the Lord and come to know Jesus Christ. As you heard her say earlier, she always felt like she was a good person. Until that one man, what did you say, he was a gay mm-hmm. man who had been an alcoholic and a drug addict, who God set him free, told her, no, you need to accept the Lord. And so I feel that there's some people watching right now that you're thinking, oh, if I could only have more money. Oh, if I could only become more beautiful. Oh, if I only had a better husband. It's something else, but really the only thing that you need is Jesus. The only thing that's going to really fill that void in your heart is Jesus. And I just feel God's heart for you, and I want you to pray, Josie, with them. I want you to lead them in a prayer, but I just wanted to articulate this to you, that Jesus is standing right there at your heart door, and he's knocking, and all you need to do is say yes to him. So, Josie, would you lead them in a prayer of salvation? Let's pretend you were talking to somebody in the men's jail.
Okay.
Many of them, I'm sure, were very down and out. And what would you say to that one watching?
Just repeat this. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on a cross for all of my sins. I ask you to forgive me for all the things that I have done that have hurt you or hurt others. And I ask you to help me to forgive the people who have hurt me. Come and live in my heart. Be my Lord and Savior. Make me the person you created me to be. I renounce Satan and all of his works. I no longer serve him. I want to serve you, Jesus, but I need your help. Deliver me from all addiction and bondage. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. And thank you, Lord, that you will show me the way. And we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. And now, if you pray that prayer, it's really not so much the words, it's really the fact that you're reaching out to God. He did come in into your heart. And now what you need to do is grow, and you need to read the Word of God, and you need to be with people that love God, who can teach you to grow and to walk in the Lord. So we only have a couple more minutes left. This question came to my mind. You know, you were around so many famous people, and you still know a lot. But you said, even in that PBS interview, that you feel richer with the peace of the Lord in your heart that many that you met or knew that lived in mansions and drove around in limos?
I don't have the cash or the fame, but I have the peace. And talking of famous for you people in Egypt, Ahmed Ramsey was my tour guide when my husband was making a film in Italy. And I went to the house of Fatan Hammer, and I know that these are two of your biggest stars, and I'm sad that Ahmed already passed away. So God bless you all, and Jesus loves you.
Amen. Well, thanks for coming on the program, Josie. And I know that God is using you, and he's continuing to use you. One last question. What are you doing now, like now that you're not in the jail and ministering there?
I do some mentoring.
Well, there's a phone call? Okay. There's a phone call.
Do we answer phone calls?
Well, they just said there's one coming in. Roll it through. Yes, can we? Hello?
They hung up. They hung up.
Okay. Well, anyway, whatever
hello,
you're...
ma'am?
Yes, hello?
Hello, hi, good evening, hello.
Hello?
Hello, good evening.
Do you speak English?
I hear you. Good evening, I say for you.
Okay, hello, how are you?
Hi, how are you? Good evening.
So would you like prayer?
Yes, I want to ask a question, please, about... you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear.
Okay. You know, I am Christian from Iraq. Many, many years, 1,435 years, Muslims, they kill us. Not just in Iraq, it's in Egypt, in Sudan, in Lebanon, in our area, all up. Too many places, Christian Muslims, they kill us. No America, no Australia, no Europe, no Canada, nobody take attention about us. Even Christian, Orthodox, or Protestant, or any kind of religion, or Catholic, whatever they call them, they don't care about us. They care about petrol money.
It's not about...
Please, I know what you... I know, we are here.
Okay, so listen, my brother, this is what we're going to say to you. We're coming to the end of the show, but listen, we do care about you. I'm very sorry for the Christians that are being killed and slaughtered in these different parts of the world. And we are constantly praying for you. And my heart really goes out to the sufferings of the people in these parts of the world. So we do love you and we do care for you. And we often pray for you. So listen, let's pray for them right now. Lord, we thank you for the people in the parts of the world that are being tormented and slaughtered. And we pray, God, that you would help them so that, Lord God, that you would give them strength. That, Lord, you said in the world we would have tribulation. But be of good cheer. God has overcome the world. If you have to lose your life, many Christians around the world are dying and losing their life. If you lose your life, the Lord said you will get a martyr's crown. So we are praying for you. We love you. And we're sorry, but know that Jesus is with you, even at the hour of your worst tribulation. And so listen, thank you for calling in, my brother. And thank you for watching. Now is the time. We thank you for listening and hearing this beautiful testimony of Josie Pollock, this wonderful woman of God. And we thank you. We know that no one said it was going to be easy. The main thing that the Lord said, he would never leave you. And so we hope to see you next week. And now is the time. God bless you. And we know that if God be for you, no one can be against you. See you next week.
In Revelation 12:12, it says, woe be to those left on the earth because the devil has come down and he's angry because he knows his time is short.
Yes.
And that's what's going on.
Yeah. Amen. Well, listen, God bless you all for watching. We'll see you next week. We're out of time. Bless you. Bye.